welcome to this video tutorial. This is the third in our series of tutorials to help you get started with Kubernetes. These videos give you practical demonstrations to show you how to containerize your applications and deploy them with Kubernetes. This video is all about why you should create a load balancer for your Kubernetes capsule cluster, and we show you how to do it. Let's start off by recapping what we did in the last two videos. As I said, this is the third in our series of videos. So where were we? In our first video, we explained what a container is and we told you why they're great. We showed you how to use Docker to containerize a simple application, walking you through the process of creating a Docker file, building an image, running the application from the image, and pushing it to the Scaleway container registry. The second video was all about deploying that containerized application from the first video with Kubernetes. So we reviewed all the basic Kubernetes concepts before creating a Scaleway Kubernetes capsule cluster. We installed kubectl on our local machine so that we could connect to the cluster. We gave it an image pull secret so that it could pull our application image from the container registry. And finally, we deployed our containerized application to the cluster. So this is what our cluster looked like at the end of the last video. It's a pool consisting of just one node with two pods running our containerized WhoAmI application. There's also the control plane, of course, but since that's managed by Scaleway, we don't need to worry too much about it. For the purposes of this video, we will assume that you've already followed the first two videos and you have deployed an application on your capsule cluster that looks a little bit like this. So before we start with the practical demonstration, let's first address the question of why we need a load balancer anyway. We need a load balancer because by default, Kubernetes clusters are not exposed to the internet. And this means that external users cannot access the application deployed on our cluster. And this is clearly a problem if we want others to be able to access it. Now, in the previous video, we solved this problem temporarily by creating a node port service for our cluster. What node port does is that it opens a port on each node in a cluster that contains pods for the specified deployment that you specify when you're setting up the node port service. And it then forwards any external traffic received on that port to the right pods. So in practice, this allowed us at the end of our last video to go to our node's external IP address in a browser, or more specifically the socket address, because we also specified the open port. You can see that down on the left of the screen here. And when we went to that address, we were served our web application. So as I mentioned, NodePort is a service, and it's important at this point to differentiate between services and deployments in Kubernetes. Deployments keep a set of pods running with containerized applications, and this is really what we focused on in the last video, was creating our deployment. Services, on the other hand, enable network access to a specified set of pods. So we created the node port service, specifying that it should give access to pods running our deployed application. So why can't we just keep using node port? Why do we need to use a load balancer? Well, node port is great for quick testing and it can be adequate for uncomplicated single node clusters. And it's also free. However, it really isn't ideal for production for reasons of security and ease of management. You're limited in which port numbers can be opened. And as your cluster starts to scale in complexity, maybe containing many different microservices, node port gets a lot less practical to use. Load Balancer is in fact a Kubernetes service, just like node port. And Load Balancer is the standard service to use when you want to expose your cluster to the internet. So as I said, it's the standard way to expose your cluster to the internet. Load Balancer service creates an external load balancer, that is to say external from the cluster, as you can see in the diagram here. The external load balancer has a single IP address that forwards all traffic to the load balancer service within your cluster, which then takes care of forwarding it to the right pods. So the external load balancer is just going to basically forward traffic to your cluster While the load balancer service within the cluster is going to be doing what we think of as load balancing in the more traditional sense, that is to say distributing traffic and load between healthy servers, or in the case of Kubernetes, between healthy pods. Load balancer supports multiple protocols and multiple ports per service, and it's much more secure than node port. And it provides all those things that are important and valued when it comes to cloud native technology: predictability, scalability, and high availability. So how do we create a load balancer? Well, honestly, it's pretty simple. How does it work? First, we create the load balancer service on our cluster by connecting to the cluster via kubectl and creating a YAML manifest to specify the load balancer service. Then the cluster's cloud controller manager, which is a component of the Kapsule's control plane managed by Scaleway, creates the external Scaleway load balancer and is responsible for all of the configuration and management of that. We can check our Scaleway console though to see that the load balancer has indeed been created. We can use kubectl to get the load balancer's IP address, and then we're ready to test everything. Now, you may be wondering why you can't just create the external load balancer yourself in your Scaleway console or via the API and then attach it to your cluster. In fact, it just isn't possible to do it this way around. You must create the load balancer service in the cluster first so that the Scaleway Cloud Controller Manager in your Kapsule's control plane can handle the creation of the Scaleway load balancer with the right configuration to direct its traffic to the correct pods of your cluster. So we do need to do it this way around. So let's get started. The first step is creating a YAML manifest for our load balancer service. Here we are in the command line, and let's just do a quick kubectl get all to check the state of our cluster. So here we can see our two pods and then our two services, the default cluster IP service and the node port service that we created in the last video. We can see here that neither of these services have an external IP address. With node port, we had to use the node's IP. And that is another advantage of load balancer, because we'll see that the load balancer service will have its own external IP address. We also have the deployment, and we have our two replica sets. So we don't really need the node port service anymore. So let's just delete that with kubectl delete service. And we called that node port service my deployment. Okay, so that's been deleted. And just remember, we're not deleting the deployment itself. We just happen to call the node port service my deployment. So it's just node port service that's been deleted. Okay, so for our new load balancer service, we're going to define that in a YAML file. So I'll create that file with nano, and I'll call it lb.yaml. And I've already prepared the text for our file. I'm going to paste that in, and we'll just go through it line by line. You should notice this looks quite similar to the YAML file that we used to specify our deployment in the last video. It's just that this time we're specifying a service. So API version specifies which version of the Kubernetes API to use to create the object. Kind specifies the kind of object defined in this YAML file. So here it's a service. Last video, it was a deployment. The metadata helps to uniquely identify our service object. So we give it a name, my load balancer, and a label. Spec specifies the service. So it's of type load balancer, and then we can define many ports if we want, but I'll just do the one necessary for our use case. Who am I app runs on port 8000. It's an HTTP port, so you see here that we added a name tag and called it HTTP. You'll also see we have both target port, and they're both 8000. Target port is the port the container accepts traffic on, so this needs to be 8000. And port is the abstracted service port. For simplicity, I've set both as 8000, though we could create a mapping if we wanted and change the port value to something else. And finally, selector tells the load balancer service which pods to redirect to. So in this case, it's the pods with containers running the app that we called my deployment. Okay, so let's save and exit that. Now we just need to tell Kubernetes to create the load balancer from that YAML manifest we just created. And the command is kubectl create from file loadbalancer.yaml. And we can see it says it's created our load balancer service. Very, very simple. So let's double check that that's happened by taking a look at our Scaleway console. So I'm going to open a browser window and go to console.scaleway.com. I should be already logged into my console. Yeah. And if I click on load balancers down here in the network section, it takes me to the list of my load balancers. And yep, we can see there's a load balancer here. So let's click it. And sure enough, this resource is auto-managed by Kapsule. All your modifications will be overwritten. So this is the load balancer that Kapsule has created. And as it says, we can't start adjusting the load balancer here. It won't count. Everything has to be done from within the cluster itself. It should also be noted that the Scaleway Load Balancer is a paid-for service. More information about that can be found by looking in the console or on our website. Something we can see here is the IPv4, so the IP, the external IP address of our load balancer. And we can see that it's 51.159.207.167. And this is important to us. Okay, so we've checked that our load balancer has indeed been created. We saw it in the Scaleway console, and we saw its external IP address. Our step three is to get our load balancer's IP address, but this time not via the console. We want to check it directly with our cluster using kubectl. So let's go back to the terminal. Just clear that. Now we saw the kubectl get SVC, get service command last time, and we'll use it again now to list all of our cluster services. So we can see the two services here. This time we still have that default cluster IP service, and we now have our load balancer service. And our load balancer service, as promised, has its own external IP address. And we can see it's 51.159.207.167, which was the same IP address that we saw in our Scaleway console. Now all that remains is to test our load balancer. That is to say, we're going to put that external IP address into our browser with the port that we opened, and we'll see what's happening. So let's go back to our browser. I'm gonna put in that external IP address and port 8000. And there it is. We can see that our Who Am I application is printing its container ID just as it's supposed to. And that's it. We're done. So creating a load balancer really is very easy. And of course, the fact that the Scaleway Cloud Controller Manager in the managed control plane of your cluster takes care of that external load balancer creation, that really helps too. You just need to create that YAML doc to specify the load balancer service, then tell kubectl to create the service, check your external IP, and you're good to go. In the next video, we'll be diving into the topic of storage to show you how persistent storage works with Kubernetes and how to implement it. Don't hesitate to try this tutorial out for yourself. All the code and the files that you need are right here. We have a written equivalent of this tutorial on our Scaleway documentation website, and I'll put the link to that in the description box. Thanks for watching. Bye.